265, 265. Stand together and sing Love Lifted Me, 265. I am forsaken.
Of God today. The Lord is good. Let's talk to him a little bit. Father in heaven, we love you. We thank you for this day. Lord, as we come into thy presence, may the Holy Spirit make us welcome. And I pray, dear God, that you bless everything today said and done. May it be sang and preached to the glory and honor of your Son, Jesus Christ. Do for us today what we can't do for ourselves. And we'll thank you and praise you because we ask it in the mighty name of Jesus. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, you may be seated. Come on, choir. Sing.
Through so many dangers and toils of this life, I have already come, and he keeps on giving the grace and the strength to just keep pressing on. He's given a promise, and I'm gonna stand on every word his holy word has said, and holding his hand, I'll never fear whatever lies ahead.
I'm gonna make it. He's already said that I would. I'll keep on trusting that he's working everything for my
good intentions I have had. Sometimes my strength, oh, it can fail. And though I have tried the very best that I could, my weaknesses prevail. But that's when I remember the promise he made, that in my weakness he is strong. And that's when I know whatever
Grandpa's already there. Because John done seen a number that no man can number. You say, how do you know that's us? Because they were washed in the blood of the Lamb. Hey! Thank you. right, let's sing his chorus here. Glory to his name. Well, glory to his name. It was there to my heart, was the blood applied. Glory to his name. Come to this fountain so rich and sweet. A hand clap of praise. It is good to be in the house of God. We're glad you're here. You may be seated. We welcome you in the name of the Lord. And if you're visiting with us today, the pew in front of you has a little card. Take it, fill it out. We'd love to have a record of your visit. Not only that, at the end of that prayer card is a place for you to put down your personal prayer request. And it's perforated. You take that off, put it into plate, or leave it at the information desk, and we will be praying for you this week. Let's make our visitors welcome. Thank you so much for being in the house of the Lord. We have some very special guests among us today, all the way from the beautiful metropolitan city of Cookeville. Yeah, Cookeville, Tennessee. Seth's mom and dad, Mr. and Ms. Presley, are here. Y'all stand up, guys. We're glad they're here. And he's a good brother. He's the last man to let you down. Amen. He's an undertaker. And nobody calls him until they need him. But we love the Presleys. They're distant kin to Elvis, if I'm not mistaken. I believe Elvis was your little brother. Is that right? And so we're excited about fellowshipping with royalty today. But y'all promise them, before they leave today, we're going to take care of their son. Amen? And we're going to do good. And but we love the Presleys. Glad to hear. Where is Brother John at? Come here, my brother. I love this dear man. A lot of you have heard this man's father preach through the years, Dr. Don Green from Lansing, Michigan. How long did your father pastor the church there at Lansing? 62?
Yeah, 62.
62 years. That's awesome. Let's see, 62. What 62 take away 35? Y'all in for it. And if y'all think I'm cranky now, you wait till I get to be an old man. There's some of y'all I'm coming after, I'm going to tell you right now. But he works for local church publishing out of that church in Lansing. And people ask me, John, all over the country, I get emails all the time, where do I get them red, original, King James, Scofield Bibles I preach from? This man right here, his ministry, and they're printing the original Scofield. They're printing other Bibles, and they're all authorized King James Version of the Scripture. And they got a lot of different colors, and they're set up in our foyer. And that'd be the best place for you to buy you a bunch of Bibles today, because you're going to go, there's coming a time, it's pretty close now, that you go in a bookstore and say, I need a King James. And they'll go, anybody read that anymore?
Yeah, right.
Yeah, a bunch of us still read it. And a few of us still believe it. And a few of them still try to live by it. Can I get an amen right there?
Amen.
And so he's set up today. You going to be with us all day, my brother? Or just?
I can be, but I was planning to go on up there.
Well, you go on up there. But before you leave today, make sure you go by the table and get you a couple of Bibles. They're full leather. Some of the best Bibles that I've used in a long time. In fact, I've been preaching out of them now every night of my life for 20 years. And if you want a good Bible, see Brother John. Let's make him welcome today, Brother John Green. Love him. Love him in the Lord. Your brother Tim has preached here many times. And we love his family. John, we're glad you're here. I want you to lead us to the Lord in prayer ask his blessings on the service. Ushers, let's come forward and get ready to receive our morning offering. Brother John, so good to have you today. So good to have you.
Thank you. It's good to be here. I enjoyed Sunday school class this morning, being with those folk over yonder in the Timothy building, and trust it was a blessing. You know, Dad was there 62 years, and he always said, I'm not here to run this place. I'm just here to see that you don't. Amen. So that was his motto, but God's good. He preached last Sunday, by the way. Still preaching. Takes him 3 days to recover from preaching, but he preaching. Amen. Let's pray. Father, we do love you today. Thank you for the worship. This time to be in God's house. Lord, I'm thinking about God so loved the world, and I'm glad that included me. Lord, I'm thankful that your grace is sufficient. I pray for every soul in this building this morning, especially those that need to come to the Lord Jesus. Come and take him. Lord, I pray. May you bless this offering, and every hand that gives, every heart that lives for thee. And we ask it in Christ's name. Amen. Amen.
Sunday, we're going to be passing out these special envelopes that we have ordered. We've mentioned about the different church projects that we're going to be building throughout the world this coming year. And one of those that's upcoming is our Harvest Baptist Tabernacle in Chile that we're going to help build. And so next week, we're going to have these offering envelopes available, and we're going to pass those out in the service next Sunday. We want you to go ahead and be praying about what the Lord would have you to do to be a part of this project. So we'll have those available next week. And then also, our contribution statements for 2019 are available now. So on your way out, if you'll go to the left side of the foyer over here, they'll have those available for you. And then let us know if you have any questions. And then don't forget two upcoming events. Friday, January 31st, we'll have a youth night here at the church. That's for every teenager. So parents, if you'll make sure your teenagers are here for that, that'll be at 7 o'clock over in the gym. And then we have two upcoming Valentine's banquet. That's for our Young at Heart Senior Adult Ministry. That'll be Saturday, February 15th at 1 o'clock here at the church. And then Friday, February 21st, for all of those couples that are in Brother Tim's Sunday School class and then Brother Tom and Brother Barry's Sunday School class, we're going to be going out to the Hannah Brothers Cafe out at Pinewood Studios on Friday, February 21st. So if you have not already signed up for that, if you'll do so at the Information Center, and we appreciate it.
Service tonight. Brother Brian, can we pull that picture up of that family? And their names are on it. I'm going to let you pronounce it any way you want to. But Brother Larry Brown, not our Larry Brown from Augusta, but the other Larry Brown from Iowa, pastored that church a long time. His son Joseph is pastoring now. They have a family out of that church. And it's a mom and dad and seven kids. They've been busy. And they all play instruments. There you go. Now, how would you like to feed all of them? Glory to God. And they're going to be with us tonight. And they play violins and banjos and guitars. And somebody said, what's there between a fiddle and a violin? Saturday night and Sunday morning. Amen. and they'll sing about 20 minutes before I preach tonight. This is a great family. You'll enjoy them, so be in the service tonight. Bring somebody that's young. Young people like and need to see other young people that are not serving the devil. They're not out getting high. They're not out getting drunk. They're not out painting the town red. They're serving the Lord, and that will encourage them to do so, and make sure that you avail yourself to that, and you'll enjoy the service tonight. It'll be a great, great blessing to you. Before I bring the message this morning, I want these girls to come and sing. A lot of us are behind on our thanksgiving and on our praise. In fact, a matter, there's a lady that used to go to our church. I said used to go to our church. And I said used to go to our church. And she got so mad at me because I would stop and say, let's lift our hands and praise the Lord. And she said, I'm leaving because I don't want to be Joe Arthur's shouting puppet. Well, I'm not saying you got to raise your hands, but if you want to, you can. But at least will you look up today and maybe lift a finger and say, Jesus, I love you. I want to thank you, Lord. And so I want them to sing that right before the message. I'm excited about preaching today. I'm going to try to do it in 22 minutes, but...
If I had 1,000 lives to live, I'd give them all to the Lord. For he has been so good to me, that is the least that I could afford. He's made the good times outnumber the bad. He's the best friend that I've ever had. So I just want to take a minute right here and say, I thank you, Lord. And I just want to thank you, Lord, for every time that you heard me pray. I just want to thank you for always being there. So down and out, you came along and you made me want to shout. So I just want to thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. And I just want to thank you, Lord, for always hearing me when I pray. I just want to thank you for always being there. I just want to take a minute right here and say, I thank you, Lord. And I just want to thank you, Lord, for every time that you heard me pray. I just want to thank you for always being there. When I was so so I just want to thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. So I just want to thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Well, praise the Lord. God is good all the time. The book of John this morning, chapter number 4, please. John chapter number 4. In a few moments, we'll go to Luke 10 and read a secondary text to illustrate the point this morning. Our theme for the whole year is 2020 vision. I bet you'll never guess where I got that theme from. 2020. But in 2020, there we want clear, perfect vision. not necessarily in the physical realm, but in the spiritual realm. And if you notice our theme, 2020 Vision, seeing the Lord and seeing the lost. Because if we get a big, fresh glimpse of the Lord and His holiness and His majesty, oh man, it'll make a difference in our life. And then as we see the Lord, we'll see a lost and a dying world who needs our Lord. And I've said this over and over again, but let me emphasize it. You'll never be more Christ-like when you look out and see the needs of lost humanity. The last time we were together and we preached upon this, we looked in John 6, where Jesus lifted up His eyes and He saw the multitude. He saw a scattered multitude and a sick multitude and a starving multitude. But He knew that there was a little lad that was going to make a contribution. And He performed a great miracle because He saw the needs of others. I call that the lifted eyes of a loving Savior. And I wonder if there's anybody in this room this morning, you're glad that one day the eyes, glory, I feel a preaching storm coming on. I wonder if there's anybody in this room this morning, you're glad that one day the eyes of a loving Savior fell across your path and He looked beyond your fault. And He saw your need. Oh, glory. Thank God for the day when I looked up, whoop, and He looked down. And not because of us, but in spite of us, He saved us, loved us. And I believe the words of the songwriter are more correct today than it's ever been. He's a Savior to be proud of. I wonder if there's anybody in this room this morning, you love Jesus. You're not ashamed of Him. The eyes of a loving Savior. And with that thought in mind, I want you to come to John's Gospel, chapter number 4 this morning, and begin reading in verse 34 and verse 35. John chapter number 4 and verse number 34, Jesus saith unto them, My meat, my purpose, my reason for coming, my meat is to do the will of Him that sent me, and to finish His work. What was the work the Heavenly Father gave the Holy Son? To meet the needs of lost humanity. And when Jesus left, He left you and I a responsibility in His stead. What is that? To meet the needs of lost humanity. And Jesus illustrates it in verse number 35. Say not ye that there are yet 4 months, and then cometh the harvest? Behold, I say unto you, say this phrase with me, lift up your eyes and look on the fields, for they are white already to harvest. Jesus said, look away from me just a moment. And lift up your eyes on the field. As we established the other morning, the multitude is the world. And in the parables, in the analogies that Jesus gave, He told us the field is the world. Our mission field is the world. Some people think it's their bank account, but it is not. The mission field is not the church bank account. The mission field is the world. God help churches that set on millions and billions and gain interest on millions and billions while millions and billions die without the Savior and go to a devil's hell. Our mission field is the world. Turn to somebody beside of you and ask them, are you breathing? Now, you smokers and garlic pill takers, we know you're breathing. But say to your neighbor, are you breathing? Then look at your neighbor and say, you're my mission field. You're my mission field. And Jesus said, lift up your eyes, the fields are ready to be harvested. And to add emphasis to it, notice the way Jesus put it in the parallel reading in Luke's Gospel, chapter number 10 and verse number 2. This is one of the passages in the Bible that grips the very gable end of my soul. Luke chapter 10 and verse number 2. Therefore said he unto them, the harvest truly is great, but the laborers are few. Pray ye therefore the Lord of the harvest, that he would send forth laborers into his harvest. And can I emphasize this morning, it's not my work, it is God's work. It is not my field, it is God's field. It is not necessarily my business, but it is God's business to reach a world that's in need of a Savior. And Jesus said, lift up your eyes and see the lost world that needs us. And if I preach this morning on the lifted eyes of a loving Savior, this morning I want to emphasize the lifted eyes of a laboring servant. Let me just say this morning, by the way of introduction, aren't you glad one day some servant of God, whether it be a preacher or whether it be a soul winner or may it be in a mission or an evangelist, but one day somebody that knows God saw you and saw your need and they got a burden for you and they begin to sow seed and the Holy Spirit began to water that seed and one day you came to Christ, you came to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ because one sowed and one planted, but it was always God Almighty that gave the increase. Someone asked me the other day, what is the greatest fear of your life? Outside of my wife's mother, the greatest fear of my life, outside of making my wife mad at me, the greatest fear of my life is to live and die and never touch no one else's life with the power of the gospel. Jesus said, lift up your eyes and see the whole world needs the Lord Jesus Christ. Let me give you three things about it in our text. Number one, I want you to see the potential. He said the fields are white unto harvest. He said the harvest truly is great. And let me ask you this morning, for such a great work, aren't you glad we've got a great book? For such a great work, aren't you glad we have a great Holy Spirit? And aren't you glad for a great work? We got a great heavenly Son, Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. And for such a great work, aren't you glad we've got a great, omnipotent, sovereign, eternal, heavenly Father? And I'm glad for such a great work, we have a great gospel that has a great message. Look unto me and be ye saved from all the ends of the earth, for I'm God, and besides me there is none else. And if you want to hear a great message, Jesus said, come unto me all you that labor and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. And if you want to hear a great message, Jesus said, the Son of Man came to seek and to save that which is lost. And if you want to hear a great message from the lips of the Savior, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, I'm telling you this morning, it is a great potential. The whole world, it is possible that the whole world come to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. You say, Pastor Arthur, I have gathered this morning that you are a whosoever willer. You have guessed absolutely correct. Boy, I'm going to try to say this and be nice, but I despise it when people take Bible words and hijack them and make them into something that it is not. And they say, well, you know, Brother Joe Arthur and Brother Brian McBride and people like that, they're good fellas and they're good old boys, but they're looking through a little keyhole and we got the door open, and they're really not that deep in the scriptures, and they're not really that smart, and they're not really that educated. I'm educated enough to know that all means all. I'm educated enough to mean that whosoever will means whosoever will. If I may borrow a line from one of my heroes, Brother Sammy Allen, he would say it like this: you can't witness to the wrong person. You can't hand the wrong person a gospel tract. You can't knock on the wrong door. You can't share the gospel with the wrong person. I'll tell you, my Bible said that Jesus Christ tasted death for every man. The message of the cross is that the rich man can come, and the poor man can come, and the wise man can come, and the foolish man can come, and the low man can come, and the high man can come, from the king upon his throne to the pauper in his lean-to. There's not a person breathing on planet earth that Jesus didn't pay the price for and go to the cross for and shed his blood for. The potential is the whole world can be saved. And they say, well, you don't understand, Reverend. I'm a grace preacher. If you preach the New Testament, you are a grace preacher. I want to tell you what grace is not. I have two children, a son and a daughter. I have a family full of grandchildren. That is so wonderful. I had to rebuke my wife the other day. She was letting grandkids get by with stuff she hanged her children for. And the more I messed in it, she almost hung me. One day I'm going to get full of boldness and I'm going to man up and I'm going to put my foot down and stand. But until then, I'm going to walk humbly before God in the fear of God. And I want to tell you, John Burdett, what grace is not. I got four little granddaughters. Stepladder. 3, 2, 1. Wait a minute. Almost. Lord have mercy. Yeah. 3, 2. I got some granddaughters. I got some granddaughters. I've got Michaela, I got McKenna, I got Heidi, and I got Holly. I don't even know their names. But John Burdett, I'm going to tell you what grace is not. One of them can be saved and the other three have to go to hell. No. That's not grace. Three can be saved but only one has to go to hell. No. All four of those little girls one day can come to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, and don't any of them have to go to a devil's hell, because the potential is the whole world can be saved. May I quote some scripture this morning? If thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in thine heart that God has raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. With the heart man believeth unto righteousness, with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. How shall they call on him of whom they have not heard? How shall they hear without a preacher? And how shall they preach if they be sent? You say the whole world's not going to be saved. I'll tell you this, if it's not, it's because somebody didn't go to them and share with them the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. The potential this morning is awesome. It is great. The harvest truly is great. We've got a great God that sent a great son that lived a great life and purchased a great salvation. And you and I have an anointing of a great spirit and a great message and a great opportunity to tell a great world about a great God who will take them to a great place. The potential is unlimited to God's salvation plan. The fields are ready to be harvested. This morning, I wanted to use your hands as some binoculars. Everybody follow, do this, and this is our spiritual binoculars. And I'm looking for a field. I'm looking for a place that needs to hear Jesus saves. In the distance, I see some little boys and girls paddling a canoe down on one of the creeks that run into the great Amazon River that runs through the great country of Brazil. Some of them's never even heard of Jesus Christ. What a field that needs a Savior. I see a jungle in the Asian continent where they've got snakes and spiders and bugs big enough to saddle up and ride. But I see little boys and girls and mamas and daddies that needs a Savior. I see a field behind the bamboo curtain. I see a field behind the iron curtain. I see a field on the plains of Africa. I see a little village in some third world country that every morning they get up and their job for the day is just to have enough food to feed the family. And boy, there may never be a group that can get to them that feed their stomach, but God, please send them a preacher that can reach their soul for the cross of Christ so they do not have to worship the sun or the moon or the river or a totem pole, but they can have the indwelling Christ who is real and personal and eternal, because somebody reached them with the gospel. I'm looking for a field this morning that needs the gospel. And I see one of the greatest fields in all the world that needs the gospel, and that's the United States of America. Trust me on this morning, west of the Mississippi River. It's hard for us that live on this side of the Mississippi to comprehend this, especially if you're from the South, the Bible Belt. There's a couple of towns in North Carolina where there's a telephone pole, and nailed to that telephone pole are 7 Baptist churches. 2 here, one there, one over yonder. In Burlington, North Carolina, where my mama lives, there's a church named New Hope. There's a church named Glen Hope. There's a church named Blessed Hope. I told them somehow to start one and call it No Hope Baptist Church. It's hard for us to comprehend. But north of the state of Kentucky, north and west of the Mississippi River are towns and hamlets and villages where there is no church preaching a clear presentation of the gospel. And this is a sideline, but let me emphasize the words of Paul. Even if an angel came down and preached another gospel besides Jesus Christ and the grace of God and the blood of Calvary, it is not a real gospel. It is not a true gospel. And it seals the fate of lost men and women and boys and girls. But right in our own country, there are towns, there are cities, there are villages, there are counties that do not have on Sunday morning a man in a pulpit giving a clear presentation of the gospel that Jesus Christ came in the world to save sinners. And they need a church like you've got. They need a church like Georgia's got. There is a field that is wide unto harvest. But wait a minute, let me bring it home. Oh, I'm glad for those fields in Brazil. I'm glad for those fields in Japan and China and Russia and the Ukraine and England and France and Sweden and Norway and church planters in Montana and Wyoming and Arizona and all these wonderful places. But get up your binoculars again. Get up your binoculars again. And I see another mission field, and it's called Metro Atlanta, Georgia. Metro Atlanta, Georgia, how it needs the gospel. Put your binoculars up again. It's coming closer. It's coming closer. I see a field. I see the metropolitan Atlanta, Georgia. And then I see the counties that make it up. And I see Henry County. And I see Clayton County and Spalding County and Pike County. And all the counties where you're from that make up the big metroplex. And put your binoculars back up. I see a public school that needs a witness. And I see your subdivision that needs the witness. I see your block that needs the witness. I see your street that needs the witness. I see your Savior that needs a witness of the saving power of the Lord Jesus Christ and the gospel of salvation. Everybody reach your hands out like this. As far as you can reach. As far as you can reach and beyond is a field that's white unto harvest. Brian, can you put just a map of the world? You see, ladies and gentlemen, that's our field. That's our field. From coast to coast and border to border and continent to continent, millions and billions of people roam the villages and the hamlets and the hills and the valleys. And I'm telling you this morning, there's not one spot on it that Jesus didn't die for the people that lives in that spot. I can't put my finger on one spot of that where Jesus didn't shed his blood and pay the sin debt. I'm telling you, I can't put my finger on one spot of the map of the world that doesn't need the gospel and a clear presentation of who Jesus is. Can I get a witness this morning that the harvest truly is great? Truly is great. The potential is unlimited to what God can do in this world, because a great God sent a great Son and he purchased us so great a salvation. Hold your hands out as far as you can reach and beyond. You say, preacher, that's pretty good. But can Brother Joe bring it home to you? If you're sitting beside one of your family members this morning, just reach over and touch their hand. That's your mission field as well. Yes, those little boys and girls in the Amazon, Jeff, need a building. They can worship God. Our missionaries goes into the prisons. Those men and women, most of them young, need the Lord. Our missionary, Brother Harper, has been in Panama this week. You ought to see the emails he sent me. The picture of those indigenous people coming to Christ. Hundreds of young people have been saved in the last 2 weeks. While we're getting ready to clip some big coupons off of that. And they need God. But can your pastor really bring it really close? Yeah, that field way out yonder is great. The metroplex of Atlanta is great. Henry, Clayton, Spalding, Pike, whatever county you're from is great. Your neighborhood, your street, your block, your subdivision. Them little boys and them little girls that sleep in our beds at night and eat food at our tables during the day. Jesus died for them too. And can I encourage every mother and every father and every grandparent in this room this morning? And I want to challenge Harvest Baptist Tabernacle. And I'm not preaching at you. I'm preaching with you. And man, I'm preaching at myself too. Oh God, while we're reaching all of the continents and the villages and where the sun is shining, and while we're reaching our state and our city and our block and our subdivision, oh, may we be reminded while we're trying to reach the world, oh God, don't let our own sons and our own daughters grow up to be reprobates and heathens and die with that God and go to hell. The people closest to us is our greatest mission field. Listen to this. I want us to reach the world. I want us to reach America. I want us to reach Georgia and the Metroplex and Clayton and Henry and Pike and Spalding and all the counties you're from. I want our church to make a biggest splash as we can for the cause of Jesus Christ. Oh, but let me tell you who I want to see come to Christ more, and the future of our church depends upon it, is the ones that sleep in our beds and eat at our table and roam our house. That's our first responsibility. That's our greatest responsibility. For
what profit a person if we gain the whole world and lose the people that is closest to it? May I say this, the person you work with is your mission field. Your family is your mission field. Every living, breathing human being on planet Earth is our job, is our field, is our purpose. Let me ask you this, church, how many believe this morning that he died for every man, that he bled for every man, that he gave every man an opportunity? Well, if he died for every man and bled for every man, let's tell every man, Jesus saved. The potential, I see it in the text. Number two, quickly, I see the problem of the text. He said the harvest is great. Finish that statement with me. But the laborers are few. Have you ever noticed he put the word few right beside the word laborers? Because laboring is hard work. You know what the Greek word for labor really means in the Bible? It means to sweat at the job. You know why I sweat when I preach? I don't want to earn my living crooked. Man's supposed to earn his living by the sweat of his face. And since you give me a salary, I want to sweat to earn it. But that word labor, if it was easy, everybody would do it. If it was convenient, everybody would do it. If it was politically correct and highly in style, everybody would do it. It is labor. It is labor to swallow your pride. It is labor to swallow your insecurities. It is labor to swallow your talents and abilities that you're afraid somebody might make fun of. It is labor to get up the courage to tell somebody that Jesus died for them. It is labor to work and pay your tithes that we may support missions everywhere where the sun and the moon shines. It is labor. It is work. It is sweat, it is toil. But can I say this? We work for a good God, we work for a good master, and our cause is great. Can I get an amen right there? Our cause is great. What a privilege. I said, what a privilege. What a privilege to stand in the gap and make up the hedge and shine like a light in a dark world. What a privilege it is to be able to tell this world our God's a way when there is no way. He reaches further down than we can reach up. There's not a sin he can't forgive. There's not a problem he can't solve. There's not a mountain that he can't climb. There's not an ocean that he can't swim. What a privilege. Oh, man. Let's step up to the plate. Let me ask you this morning in passing. Aren't you glad when you was a sinner, lost without God, that was somebody that got to you? The laborers are few. I see the potential. I see the problem. But here's what I'll emphasize just a moment. Notice the prayer in this text. Jesus said, I know the harvest is great, and I know the laborers are few. He said, here's what you're going to do about it. He said, pray. Pray that the Lord of the harvest would send forth laborers into his harvest. And boy, this hit me this week right in the middle of the Gulf of Mexico. I almost jumped overboard. And I thought, I don't know how to swim, so I better not do that. This thing hit me about praying that the Lord of the harvest would send forth laborers into his harvest. And it hit me. There are three prayers for laborers in the Bible. The first one is in the Old Testament. I preached on it three Sundays ago in Isaiah 6. Isaiah got to see and hear something, Brother Mike, most people never get to hear and see. He got to hear God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost having a throne conversation. He got to hear the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Man, most people don't get to hear that trio. Isaiah heard it in Isaiah 6, and those beside of John the Baptist, being baptized by Jesus in Jordan, heard it when the Holy Ghost came on the wings of a dove, and the Son of God got out of that river, and the Father thundered from the glory world, "This is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased." Let me tell you something, buddy. It's big business when God the Father shows up. It's big business when God the Son shows up. It's big business when God the Holy Ghost shows up. But when Father, Son, and Holy Ghost all show up at the same time, it's going to be an earth-shaking event. And he looked and he heard a conversation, and he heard the triune God literally praying and asking, "Who will go for us?" The Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. Who will go for us? Who shall we send? He heard the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Who shall we send? Who shall go for us? And I want to tell you, brother, Brother Mark, that's all Isaiah could take. He jumped up and said, "Lord, have mercy. The Father, the Son, the Holy Ghost, let me answer your prayer. Here am I. Here am I. Here am I. Here am I. Send me." I got a preacher friend of mine. I love him dearly. Pastored a great church, bigger than this one four times. Great salary, great benefits. He had it made in the shade. And a missionary came by and talked about a little town and a little village out west that didn't have a Bible gospel preaching church within 250 miles. He said, "Boy, that touched his heart." He said the next morning he was in his study praying and seeking God to be anointed by the power of the Holy Spirit. Boy, I'm glad there's a few people that still believe in that. I'm glad there's a few people that still believe in that. And he said, "I was on my face, Joe, praying for the anointing and the power of the Holy Spirit of God." And he said, "I began to pray, Lord, that little village in Utah, that little town in Utah, they need a gospel church. There's not one in 250 miles. God, send them a preacher. God, send them a preacher. God, send them a preacher." And he said, "About that time, the Holy Ghost said, I think I'll send you." What? He said, "I think I'll send you." He said, "I stopped praying right there. Walked out of my study, tried to eat my breakfast, tried to eat my lunch, tried to go visit people, tried to do my pastoral duties, tried to study." He said, "It was like the Empire State Building was on my chest." He said, "Sometime that evening, I went back to my study where I left God, and I said, Lord, let me pick you up where I shoved you off. If you want me to go, I'll go." And I'm talking a man already in his mid-50s stood up and said, "Okay, if that's where you want me to go, Lord, if you want to send somebody, here am I, send me." I tell people this every night of my life across this great country, the United States of America. You say, "Preacher, do you think God's got a place for me? Do you think God can use me?" I'll tell you what you do this morning with sincerity. You get on your knees and lift your hand and wave the white flag of surrender and say, "God, if you're looking for somebody to put the Holy Ghost on to tell a lost and a dying world that Jesus saves, you volunteer and you'll find out God will use anybody that'll say, here am I, send me." I got a buddy of mine's in glory, and you loved him too. The sweet singer of the South, Lance Carpenter. I have never heard an angel pluck a harp, but I believe Lance on that 12 string is close. He used to have a statement. I had forgotten it, but a dear friend of ours this week reminded me of it. He looked at a dear friend of mine that was struggling and called his name and said, "Son, listen to me. The Lord will let you do things the brethren won't let you do." You say, "Well, I want to serve God, but there's no Christians that have put their approval on what I want to do." Well, I'm sorry to tell you that. That might even be true, knowing some of that crowd I know. But I want to tell you there is somebody that can only... that can not only put His approval upon you, He can put His hand on you, Lord God, and He can put His favor on you. And I'll answer that sing to, honey. He can put His breath upon you. And if you got God's hand and God's favor and God's breath, there's nothing you can't do for the cause of Jesus Christ. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost is praying, and somebody needs to pick up the telephone and say, Lord, here am I, send me. The sovereign's praying. Well, then I read in the book of Acts where the saints are praying. The man in Macedonia realized that was more than he could get done himself. And he began to pray, oh God, send us somebody. Oh God, send us somebody. And it's called the Macedonian call. And Peter answered the call, and Paul answered the call, and the early apostles answered that call. Come over and help us. Come over and help us. Listen real close. I want you to get your binoculars out and look around with me. Then I want you to get your spiritual hearing aids. I want you to look through your binocular. I got that right. Look through your monocular in one hand and get your spiritual hearing aid to your ear and just listen. I see and I hear. I see and I hear. I see and I hear a little missionary somewhere that thinks he's got more to do than he can get done. He's saying, help me, help me, help me, help me. He needs your money. He needs your gifts. He needs your prayers. He needs your pleading for the souls of mankind. Let's enter the call of the saints. Let's help those who have a call and a burden to fulfill the responsibility in the cause of Christ. It is a cause worth stepping up to the plate for. I hear the call of that Savior, the prayer of the Savior, and that saint. But in the Gulf of Mexico at 4:30 in the morning, it's hit me. There's somebody else. There's somebody else praying. There's somebody else pleading with God that He would send laborers into His harvest. Yes, it is God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Yes, it is our fellow laborers of the gospel. Yes, it is missionaries across the world. But there's somebody else. It's in Luke's gospel, chapter number 16. And He's called a rich man. He didn't go to hell because he's rich. He went to hell because he rejected Christ. The same reason you and I'll go there if you reject Jesus Christ. I'll preach more on this next Sunday. But let me whet your appetite with this. The King James is so eloquent. It said He lifted up His eyes. He could see. He's in outer darkness, but He can see. And evidently He can feel, because He said, I'm tormented, I'm twisted in this flame. He got thirsty. He could hear the screams of the damned around Him. He had His mental faculty. He could remember. He remembered, but He could still speak. And He's begging the God of heaven for mercy finally. And He's begging for one drop of water to cool His tongue. You talk about a man of God sweating when he's preaching. If I could dig a hole from here to hell and lean my sweaty brow over the pit and sell the drops of sweat off my face for a dollar a drop, I'd be a rich man. I'd be a rich man. In hell, they're screaming for one drop of water and one moment of relief. But there is no relief and there is no water. But that rich man is crying out and praying for something else. Father Abraham, I got some brothers. I got some brothers, and they're coming to the same place of torment. Send Lazarus. Send Lazarus. send him to my father's house. Let him warn my brothers, lest they, let me tell you something, hell don't want no company. And there's no rock bands or no midnight comedians in hell singing songs and making jokes about it, buddy. It's not a place of rivalry and fun where your buddies go. No, it is a place of eternal torment and damnation and separation against God and from God. But he said, send Lazarus. Let him warn my brethren, lest they come. And boy, God said to the rich man, they got the Bible, they got Moses, they got the prophets, they got the preachers. And the rich man said, but wait a minute, wait a minute. But there's Lazarus. Surely they will believe somebody like him who's been raised from the dead. Really? Well, let me just ask you this morning in closing, who's the greatest man that's ever lived on planet Earth? That died not by his own sins, but was raised from the dead 2,000 years ago and is still alive. His name is Jesus. Oh, there is somebody raised from the dead, and his name is Jesus. And I'm telling you, brother, if the pathos of Jesus, if the compassion of Jesus, if the person of Jesus is not enough to persuade men, they will die without him and go to hell. But oh, down in that pit, send Lazarus, send Lazarus, send Lazarus. There's somebody praying for God to send you. In the closing moments of our service this morning, I want to ask you a very important question. Put your spiritual hearing aid on. Could it be that this last Sunday of January 2020, 12 minutes after 12, that way down yonder in the very pit of hell itself is somebody calling your name? Somebody you work with, somebody you lived around, maybe a brother, a family member, somebody that lived in your neighborhood, somebody you went to school with, they heard you got saved. They heard you became a Christian. They didn't, but they heard you did. And they died without Christ, and they're in hell this very moment. Could it be that there's somebody in hell screaming out, name, God send Joe, God send Tom, God send Jay, God send Spencer, God send Brandon, God send Julie, God send Lisa. I'm just asking you, I wonder today if there's somebody in hell screaming out your name for God to send you. I can tell you this morning, somebody's praying. We need to pick up the phone and answer and say, I'll go. Remember, while we're trying to reach the world with the gospel, there are people that we literally touch physically every day of our life. And they are just important in God's sight is the Word. God has placed this country preaching for 35 years of his life in Metro Atlanta, Georgia. You know where I really should be? Up in a holler somewhere, chewing tobacco with the rest of the ladies in the church. On the backside of nowhere, picking my guitar, because I'm as country as cornbread. Why? Why would God reach in the Blue Ridge Mountains of Virginia and reach in the hills of North Carolina and get somebody like me and my wife who grew up just like John Boy and the Waltons? Don't make fun of Mayberry. That's where she's from. Goober is her cousin. And put me in Metro Atlanta, Georgia. 35 years of my sojourn. You listen to me one time, I'm not going to chew my cabbage twice, and you ain't heard the last from Ernest T. Bass. I refuse. I refuse to reach all kinds of people from all kinds of races and all kinds of backgrounds all over the world, and let them same people die without God and go to hell in my city. I refuse to do that. You realize where we sit this morning? We sit in the heart of Metro Atlanta. We're 20 minutes from the greatest, biggest, most powerful airport in all the world. The mission field has come to us. The mission field has come to us. They're not our color. They're not our style. They're not of our background. They speak different. They live different. They act different. But my God, we've got a couple of things in common. They need a Savior, just like we need a Savior. And Jesus died for them, just like He died for us. And what a shame it would be for us to spend millions and millions across the world to keep people out of hell and let people in our neighborhoods and our streets and our corners and our villages and our hamlets right around us die and go to hell. We will not do that. We refuse to do that. We have resolved. Somebody help me right there. We have resolved to make the message clear and plain. Christ receiveth sinful men. And John, even them behind the prison bars, even the homeless, the poor. Every church needs some poor people in it. That's a bunch of us here today. Can I get a witness right there? No, we're not poor. We may not be rolling in the dough. How many had a warm place to sleep last night? You had good clothes to put on this morning. And I can tell by looking, most of us have had plenty to eat. There's a few people in here that's wormy, but that's your own choosing. How many has been blessed? Graciously blessed. Somebody needs you today. They need that gift you're going to put in that offering plate so we can support missionaries in Japan and in the Amazon and in Panama. But there's somebody right next to your house. And there's somebody that sits at your table that calls you mommy, daddy, papa, grandmama, little mama, big mama. The harvest is great. The labors are few. And here's what we're going to do about it. Oh God, in Jesus' name, use me somehow to make up the hedge and stand in the gap, and Lord, send others to answer the call. Let me ask you this in closing. I wonder if there's anybody here this morning, you're glad when you was a sinner on your way to hell, somebody answered the call. And they touched your life. Someone's begging and asking for your help today. Let's step up to the plate and fulfill the purpose of God. Let's get our eyes off of ourselves and one another and see Jesus and see a lost and a dying world that needs the gospel. We're standing all over the building this morning. Our Heavenly Father, we love you. We thank you this morning for the gospel.
We thank you, Lord, this morning for the privilege to be involved in the greatest work in the universe. That's the proclamation of the gospel. Lord, you're praying. The Father's praying. The Holy Spirit's praying. The saints of God are praying. The lost sinners in hell are praying. May somebody answer the call today. Give their best and give their all and give their life to fulfill the gospel call. In Jesus' name. People have already started to come. We'll make room for